Hello, everyone. Welcome to day six of Web Lab. It's been a pretty fun journey so far, and we'll get started with a couple announcements. So first of all, milestone one is now complete. We had a great time listening to all of your project pitches and giving feedback on them. If you were out of town or had any reason that you missed your milestone one slot, please submit a recording of your presentation as soon as possible, ideally by midnight tonight. And send that to us as a private Piazza post, and we will give you feedback on it and give you credit for it. If you came for one of the slots but did not have a wireframe, we told you to submit a wireframe on Piazza afterward, so please do that. Also by 11:59 p.m. tonight. You can do that in a private Piazza post, and we'll get that sorted out for you. You must complete all the milestones, including milestone one and milestone zero, to get credit for this class and or be eligible for the competition. So if you want to compete or if you want credit, you will have to do this. If you can do a final submission, you can do a milestone one. It's a lot simpler than making a full-fledged website. So just, yeah. If you need any help on anything, content related or project related, or just set up anything else, if you wanna ask us stuff, come to office hours tonight at 7 to 9 p.m. in 32082. We will also be holding some stuff virtually. If you want to, you know, chill at home, you can join the help queue at weblab.is/queue, and we'll get to you shortly. With that being said, we'll dive right into a bit of a recap of what happened last week. So what have we learned so far? We talked about HTML. It's, you know, the sort of the basic building blocks of websites. We talked about CSS, which is how we style it and make it look good. We talked about JavaScript, which is kind of the brains. It's what does all the thinking behind the website. We have React, and React is a way to structure websites on the front end. I'm using a sort of nested component structure. We have Node.js, which sort of manages all of our dependencies in our project. We have Express, which is what we run our server on. We have Git and GitHub for version control. We have Figma for design. We have Mongo for our database. And that's all in 1 week. So that's kind of crazy. And you might think that you're completely lost, but don't worry, you actually know a lot more than you think. And so we'll just brush up on some of that just now. So we can start off our recap with sort of the first stuff we learned. We have three main web development languages that we'll be focusing on during Web Lab. The first is HTML. That's kind of the bread and butter. It's the sort of bones of your website. We have the CSS. That's your layout, the styling. That's what makes it look good. It's everything that's sort of on top of that, skeleton. We have the JavaScript, and that's all the interaction. It's the organs. It's the brain of your website. It's what makes it tick. And then let's talk about React. So React is a system on the front end built on JavaScript that allows you to structure your web development code into a sort of nested component tree, as you might see here. So you have like separate components, and each component can have child components within them. And this helps us organize our code to be much more readable and much more user-friendly and developer-friendly. We talked about props. So props are inputs passed from a parent component to a child component. So for example, a parent component might be something like a post on a social media website, and it might pass in some information like the name of the person posting it, or the name of a comment that's been posted on it, whatever the content of that comment is, maybe when it was posted. And this information is then passed to the child component, which then renders it itself. Notably, a parent can have multiple child components. It can pass sort of different information to each one. We talked about state, which is very different from props. So state is private information that is maintained by the component. Something like an example, what might be the number of likes on a post, or whether a user has liked a post, et cetera, information like that. And so the most important thing about the state is that it is private to the component itself. So for example, the number of likes on one comment is not going to influence the number of likes on another comment. Notably, you can also change the value of state by interacting with this component. So for example, if I like this component or I like this comment, it will increase the number of likes by one. And so that is the state for this comment. We can talk a little bit about how we actually write React code. So here's like a little snippet. I'll briefly walk through some of the components, some of the pieces of this. First of all, we have to define our component. Remember, components are functions in React. There actually are other versions of components, but for our purposes, we're using components as functions. And the way you define it is you write const, the name of the function or component equals parentheses, and then you have a sort of arrow, and then the curly braces indicate the sort of body of this function or the body of the component. And you pass in the props as a parameter. Remember, there is an export at the bottom of the file that exports as something like export default and then the name of the component. This allows React to use this component in other files and in other components. Basically, it allows us to do that sort of nesting structure. If we look at this line here, this line is an example of sort of setting a state or initializing a state. So the way that you define it, you write const, you do this sort of two element array that has the name of the state and then set the name of the state. And so the name of the state itself is just whatever state variable you want. For example, if I want to know the value of this thing, I just use state one. And then if I want to set the value of this thing, I have to use set state one. I can't just write state one equals whatever. That will not work. You have to use set state. The use state thing on the right is how we actually initialize the state. And the value within the parentheses is the initial value. So it'll be set essentially as default to one in this case. You can put whatever you want in the parentheses, by the way. Now, the next thing I want you to look at here is the use effect part. So this is just something that runs whenever something happens. We'll get a little bit more in depth into that in a minute. But this specific example just runs when the component first loads or first renders. You can do stuff like, you know, calling APIs, doing random setup stuff, whatever you want in the use effect hook. And we'll talk a little bit more about the use effect hook in a minute. Now there's this return statement at the bottom. So this return statement is where you actually write the stuff that you want this component to do, like what it to look like. And so the stuff that you put in the return statement is this sort of HTML-like code that we call JSX. Remember, you can use parentheses. The start and end of the return statement to enter this JSX environment and start typing this sort of HTML-like stuff. And then if you want to ever insert a JavaScript variable, you can just use the curly braces to go back to JavaScript. So you can use parentheses to enter JSX, use curly braces within JSX to go back to JavaScript. And so this way you can sort of write HTML code, but also embed variables or other information that you have. You can also embed like functions or anything else you define in your file, and you can use that as well. All right, so let's talk a little bit about props. I showed you how to use state, but for props, the way you do this is, for example, in this case, I have an example of app.js, and like sort of big level component. One of these subcomponents here, might be a little hard to see, but it says intro, and that is a component that we've defined in a separate file. And how we pass in a prop is we literally just take the name of the prop we want. So in this case, education equals, you can put whatever you want. In this case, it's set to a string called Massachusetts Institute of Technology. We also have the city prop set equal to Richfield, Connecticut. You don't have to put a hard-coded string. You can put in whatever sort of JavaScript variables, et cetera. Just remember if you use curly braces to type JavaScript in here. Now, in order to access this, for example, look at the actual intro component. We remember we have to pass in props as a parameter to our function. So that's at the top. And then in order to actually get the values of the things that we just made, we have to unpack it out of the props. And that is by using props.education, because education is the name of the prop that we just defined, or props.city if we want to get the city value. So you can define whatever prop values you want here, but remember, you just have to unpack it using props dot and then the name of the prop. So that's how you use props. Now let's recap about the sort of general way that components render, because this is actually pretty useful information. And you might run into some bugs related to this. So notably, we mentioned that components have something called triggers. Triggers are things that happen or that tell the component to do something. So for example, when the component is first loaded onto the page, like you just go to a website, you load the page, component renders, or maybe something happens in the back end, the component needs to like change its information, change what it shows to you. Those are things that trigger the component to what is called a re-render or a render. And so what React will do is it will take the code in the body of the function, it will run it, and it will also tell all of its subcomponents to do the same thing. And then it will then display all of this stuff to the, like what you're actually looking at on the computer screen. So We can talk a little bit about the component lifecycle. This diagram might seem pretty complicated, but don't worry, it's not actually as intimidating as it is. So mount is what we call the component first loading onto the page. So if you open a new web page or you go to it, you like maybe you go to a new site, you open facebook.com, et cetera, that's when everything mounts. And so a mount is a trigger. It will cause React to render all the things that it has. So when you go to a web page, it will render, you know, the web page will render all the components on the page. Now, if something changes, like let's say you like a post, you want to change the number of likes on this component. Well, you want to be able to see that. So that will change a state, maybe like the state is the number of likes. And then that will trigger React to do a new render of that particular post or that particular comment. And then it will change the number of likes accordingly, and you'll be able to see it. So anytime a state changes or a prop changes, it will update the component and it will tell React to do a new rendering. And if React decides to render a given component, it will also render all of its children or child components or descendant components. We also have this thing called dismount. That is if you leave the web page or you go to a different web page. So for example, you close the tab, facebook.com. Well, now you no longer see anything. You can actually put stuff in this dismount and tell React to do certain things like when the user leaves the page. Not really important right now, but we'll get more into that like in some future workshops. We'll tell you like, you know, some stuff that you might want to consider putting into dismount. But yeah. One important thing to note is that if you change something like a value of a variable on a component and that thing is not a state or a prop, so if you just have like a random variable laying around like, and then you decide to change it without using set state or anything, that will not cause React to a re-render. So if you have, for example, a server that is telling your, you know, your client like some information and that is not triggering any sort of state change or prop change, React will not change its display. And so this is actually something that happens pretty often. It's kind of a very easy bug to make. So just be careful if you want to, if you, you know, do some change and you don't see anything happening on the screen, it's probably because React isn't re-rendering anything because it doesn't know that a state or prop has changed. So remember, you have to do an update to like a state or prop in order for it to trigger a new render. Yeah, so now let's talk about that use effect hook I mentioned earlier. So use effect is very, or it's like a very, very useful hook. It's a very useful thing that you will definitely be seeing a lot in your own projects. Here's a bunch of words that I don't like to read. So I'm actually going to skip this because the most useful information is just right here. So use effect is essentially something that lets us run a function, like any function in the file with certain conditions. So at the very bottom example here, this is a way of using use effect to run a certain function after every or after any state or any prop has changed. So essentially, whenever React decides to re-render, it's like run this function. So you just use effect, put whatever function you want in there, and that's it. So if you decide to change any state, if for example you're looking at a post, the number of likes changes, it'll run this function. If you want to run a function once only, for example, at the start of loading your component. So for example, like you just want to fetch some information, make some API calls maybe. You can pass in a second parameter to use effect as an empty array, which is like the second example here. So this, what this does is it calls the function one time only when the component first renders. So if anything else changes, it won't call the function again. It'll just do it once only and then call it a day. If you want to call the function whenever a certain variable or variables change, you can put in those variables in the second or in the array of the second parameter. So just like the first example here, we have like an array with variable one, variable two. So if any of these things change, it will redo the function. So, you know, an instance in which you might find this useful, like suppose, you know, you're tracking the number of likes on a comment and this like is like some state on your component. Maybe you want to like do something, maybe you want to send confetti whenever like the number of likes changes. You can maybe like, you can have a function that, you know, sends confetti and that is triggered by like in this like sort of array, you have like the number of likes. So whenever the number of likes changes, it does something. So that's why you might want to use a use effect hook like this. So these will be basically, these are like essentially all the ways you can use effect. It's just sort of to describe when you want to trigger a certain function, but yeah. Let's talk about the server now. So what is a server? We talked about this, I think, on Thursday. Server is just a computer, not your own computer, like not the computer that you're actually looking at the website on. It's somewhere far away that is running all of your server side code. And you as a client will be able to send requests. You can talk to the server, tell the server what you want. Maybe ask the server for some information. And the server will then try to do whatever you're trying to tell it to do. And it will send a response back to you. Note that you can have one server do this for many different clients at the same time. So, you know, there's millions of people on Facebook. They're all accessing Facebook server and trying to ask it, you know, to show me posts or to post things, post stories, comments, et cetera. And the server sort of handles all of this stuff. Now, why do we need a server? Well, one important thing to note is that the server is sort of where all of the files, the sort of central files of your, all the information of your site is going to be located. It's centralized. So all the different clients have access to the same stuff. For example, you know, if I log in on my phone or on my computer, the information is not actually stored on my device. It's going to be stored on a server, which then can send me that information. So I can access it from, you know, whatever sort of device. You know, if I have a friend that wants to access something, they can all access this sort of information. Also, remember that the client data is always, you can assume it to be public. It's anyone can look at it. If you have secure files that you want to keep away from everyone, maybe you don't want everyone to know certain information, you can put that on the server and the server can tell who gets to look at it and who doesn't get to look at it. All right, so how do we talk to the server? We have something called HTTP requests. HTTP or Hypertext Transfer Protocol is a way to just sort of communicate on the internet. There's two notable types of HTTP requests that we'll be using. There's a lot more, but for our purposes, we'll just be using two. And that is the GET request, which is sort of asking the server for some information, and the POST request, which is telling the server to do something or to, you know, add some new information. And so the way that you actually interact with HTTP is through something called API endpoints. And so we'll talk a little bit about that. So APIs are just sort of a set of rules that tell you what you can do on a server. So like how the client can talk to a server. Maybe like it's, you can think of it as like the menu on a restaurant. So like what things the client can order. So the API endpoints are sort of various functions that you can call from the client. So for example, in something like this, /get/get/pet/this pet ID thing. Maybe you'll define an endpoint on the server that allows you to call, you know, /pet/with a pet ID. And maybe the server will do something like, it'll just give you the name of a pet with this ID. But you can define these however you want to. And they can do sort of whatever stuff you need on the server. In order to call an API from the client, we use this sort of get or catch notation. We've actually implemented get and catch for you in the skeleton as well. So you don't have to do that, but you'll just be essentially using get or post. And you can sort of pass in the name of the API endpoint. In this case, it's something like /API/stories to get stories. Remember, we have to use .then in order to do stuff with what we get back. So we use something like .then. We get some result back. In this case, it's like story objects is our result, and we can do something like setting state on the front end, or we can do some computation, whatever. But we have to use .then in order to do stuff with our response. If we want to do something when the API call fails, like maybe the server had an error, it wasn't able to send back any response, we can use .catch in order to handle that. Usually, hopefully, you won't have to use .catch that much, but it's definitely very useful just to know when something goes wrong. And this .then and .catch notation is actually sort of from asynchronous stuff, asynchronous JavaScript. And remember that JavaScript is asynchronous, or is an asynchronous programming language, which means that, you know, one line of code or like any sort of request does not have to complete before you sort of move on to the next line of code. In order to make sure that you're doing stuff with the actual values that you get back, we have to use something called promises. So promises are just a sort of a guarantee that you will get some value eventually. So they will either resolve to being fulfilled, which means, you know, the promise was done, it gave you a value back, you can do stuff with that value, or it can, you know, break somewhere along the lines, and then it just like gives you an error, and that is when a promise is rejected. So asynchronous functions like get and post that we've implemented for you return promises. And so in order to actually do stuff with those promises, we have to use dot then syntax, which is like this we showed, like use dot then or dot catch on the promise. And that will let you run stuff with the actual value that it resolves to. So for example, in our earlier thing, dot then does something when the promise is fulfilled, dot catch does something when the promise is rejected. All right. One thing we mentioned is that async await is a really nifty notation that lets us sort of rewrite stuff that we want to do with promises. So if you are writing a ton of asynchronous code, you might find async await to be very helpful. Sometimes if you're only writing a little bit of asynchronous code, it's not really that useful, but it is a very sort of nifty notation that you might want to check out. A quick example, we can write this same code in two different ways. On the left with the traditional like dot then notation, and then on the right with the async await notation. Reminder that you have to use await inside of an asynchronous function or an async function. And then you have to actually call the async function in order to use it. So like on the left, you'll see it just, you get something from like using this get function, use dot then, that's the end of the story. But on the right, you actually have to wrap the whole thing in a function that says async. And remember, you can just define a function as being async by putting async in front of the parentheses. And then you can use await within that function. In this case, for await, get API stories, we'll just wait for the value of the API to return something. And it will set that value to story objects. And then we'll call this sort of async function afterward, get stories at the end. And let's just use our async function. So it sort of depends on how much async you're actually going to be using. In this case, the async await notation is a bit more complicated and a little more involved. So maybe it's not worth using it, but there are definitely some circumstances where you might have a ton of asynchronous things happening at the same time, and you really want all the information in one place before you can start doing something with it. And so in that case, using async await notation will be very helpful. Now, how do you write your own API endpoints? We mentioned something called the router, and that is in the api.js file. If you ever take a look at the skeleton or take a look at Catbook React, we have this api.js file that's something called router. Router is basically what tells the server what things are allowed on the menu. It's like the actual menu itself, essentially. And then you can put things on this router or like on the menu by using router.get for get requests. So you can write something like this, router.get. You can put the name of your endpoint, in this case, slash comment. So the client would call this by saying get slash API slash comment. You remember you have to pass in rec, which is request, and res, which is response. So rec is a request, is where all the information the client sends over is sort of packaged into, like client's ID. Maybe they can pass in some information with their get request. Like they want to find a specific or comments for a specific post, they'll pass that information in the request. And then the server can then respond in their response with, you know, whatever it decides to send over. This sort of middle section, don't worry too much about it. It's basically just server does server things after the client tells it, you know, what it wants, right? So you can put whatever you want in here on the server and then send back a response at the end. If you want to do a post request, it's like pretty similar. The only notable difference is instead of using router.get, use router.post. You can use the same name for the endpoint for both get and post requests. So for example, we have a get comment and post comment. These are two different API endpoints because one of them you'll be calling with get slash API slash stories, and one of them you'll be calling with post slash API slash stories. Make sure you still have the same request and response things. Those are the same for both. The actual body of this API call is like not super important, but you know the server can kind of do whatever it wants. You can put stuff in here, let the server know like you know what you want it to do. You should still send back a response. You technically don't have to, but it will just make your code a lot less buggy because sometimes if your server doesn't send back any response, your client might be waiting to hear back, and if it never hears back, the promise never fulfills, nothing happens. So you should usually send a response even if it's blank. For example, if you're just updating something on the server, maybe you don't need to, you might think, well, there's not really a need for response. You should still send something, like just send, for example, an empty object over, just so the client knows that it actually worked. That's the main thing. Now, I talked about databases. Databases are there to sort of protect our data from the server going down. Like, for example, if the server you're running on just burns down and you have to restart it, or maybe load the information to a new server and restart it, well, all your data is going to be lost, and you don't want that to happen. So we can have our data live somewhere else, and that's going to be on a database. For our purposes, we'll be using MongoDB. There are plenty of other databases out there, but I think Mongo is just pretty easy to use, very powerful. So it's like pretty good overall. So there's a lot of words on this page. You don't have to read all of them, or like most of them. But the way that, you know, a general post request might work from the client is you, like, you know, sitting on your laptop, will send maybe some post request, maybe on a post story to the server. That server will then save that information somewhere. And so it will then put it, or a send request to the database, you know, put that information in the database and store that. For example, if you want to do a get request to get stories, you'll ask the server to give me some stories. That server will then go through its database, because you can almost imagine like a sort of warehouse of files, you know, search for all the stuff that it wants, get it back, and then send it to you as the response of your request. So that's kind of like the server is the sort of middleman. It's the person that's managing all this information. It's managing all the clients. But the information actually does not live on the server. It just lives like in its warehouse. And then the clients are separate. So it's sort of like the one controlling everything. The actual structure of a database, or a Mongo database, has something called instances. You can think of instances like warehouses. Each instance has multiple databases. And each database you can kind of think of as like a sort of a single like container, or like single like storage container. And then within each database, you have collections, which are like crates. Each collection might have documents, which are like individual items, like a plushie like this. And each document might have certain properties that you want to store. So in this case, you have like the color, the length, how poofy it is, how angry it is, et cetera. So this kind of information is what you put in the fields of your document. So here's like a sort of a picture of the structure of a Mongo database instance, you know, sort of nested structure. But yeah. And if you want more words, here are some more words. I'm not going to read them. Now remember that in Mongo, it does not guarantee that all documents in a collection have the same structure. So you can store like users, you can store comments, you can store posts, sort of all in the same box. But this is pretty annoying, and this has caused a lot of bugs that you might not intend. For instance, if you are like, let's say you have an example like screws, bolts, like screwdriver, light bulbs, et cetera, all in the same container, and maybe you ask the database to give you everything with, you know, a certain, like for example, if you're looking at screws, right? You might consider like looking for screws that have a flathead or like a Phillips head screw. Well, if you're looking at a light bulb, flathead and Phillips head don't really make sense. So this will cause your software or your program to sort of error out and potentially crash the server. So in order to protect this or stop this from happening, we have something called Mongoose. So Mongoose uses these things called schemas to restrict what can be in each collection. So it essentially tells a collection, you can only have this kind of thing in it. It has to follow the exact format, and that is what we call a schema. So a schema, an example of a schema might be something like this. You have a schema, you can define certain fields, like for example, name is a string, age is a number, hobbies might be an array of strings, et cetera. And every document in it has to follow this schema. So I have an example of something that follows the schema on the right. You know, you can set a name, an age, a hot, like, you know, an array of strings for hobbies, et cetera. And if you don't follow the schema, it will not let you put it into the database. So it will essentially protect you from making potentially these like sort of organizational problems on your database, which could cause your server to crash in the future. Now, how do we actually use a schema? We make the schema defined as sort of shown, and then we use something called a model in Mongoose, which just takes a schema and sort of makes it an actual thing that we can make in JavaScript. So we use mongoose.model and then put the schema in there. We can do cool stuff with this model once we made it. Like for example, if we want to make a new document, we can just define new and then that model, put in our information, and then use .save. And .save will then just send that information off of the database, and the database will create a new document for you. We can find documents. So we use the name of the model, .find, and that will allow us to get our information from our database. You can pass in parameters to find. If you pass in nothing, it'll just find everything that is in this collection. So for example, users.find or user.find, and then just an empty object or this empty curly braces will find all the users in the database and just return them as a massive list or massive array. You can put in certain conditions, like you want the name to be Tim, or you want the name to be Tim and the age to be 21, and that'll give you only the documents that satisfy those properties. So maybe you want to search for, a certain person, or you want to search for certain contents in your comments, maybe. You can use .find, you can pass in whatever information you want in there. You can use something called find one. Find one gives you only one thing from the database. It just gives you the first one that it sees. Please do note that there is not really an order in which Mongo stores its stuff. So if you do something like find one and then just an empty bracket, it'll just give you a random student. You actually have no way of telling really what that student or which student it is, but it will give you a student or a user. You can also pass in parameters to find one. Like for example, you can pass in name is Tim and it will find a student named Tim. If there's nothing, it will just return undefined or null, and you can kind of check for that. And I guess one important thing to note is that find returns an array, and find one returns the actual document itself. So in find, for example, if there's only one thing, it will just return an array with one thing in it, one document in it. But find one will actually return that document. So the actual return things are a little bit different, just worth mentioning. All right, you can also delete stuff. Maybe you don't want certain things in your database. When I get rid of them, you can use user.delete1 to delete one instance of a thing. So in this case, user.delete1 searches for the first document that satisfies whatever conditions, whatever parameters you set, and gets rid of it. You can use user.deleteMany or just .deleteMany to get rid of all of the things that satisfy that property. There's also, you can edit information. You know, changing information is very useful, obviously. And the way you do that is use find one to get one document, and then, you know, change whatever that is, .save updates it. So that's pretty much how that works. Talk about authentication. Authentication is very hard. Storing passwords securely is very complicated. We don't really ask that you have to do a lot of these things. So we have Google Auth to do it for us. And so Google, essentially, or how it works, like a really quick overview. The user asks Google for, or logs into Google with password and email. Google will give it a token. The user then gives this token to the server, and the server will then check that token with Google and say, is it legit? You know, maybe Google says it's legit. Then the user will be able to access whatever we wanted to on the server. If the user tries to log in with a fake password, Google will not give them a token. They can try to make one up and give it to us, but if we check it with the Google Auth library, it will tell us that it is fake and it will not be able to access anything. That's kind of how Google Auth works. It's even with that, it's a little bit involved. So it's in the skeleton that we provide to you. You should use it. And that's it. So that's actually pretty much all the content for the last week, summarized in about 35 minutes. So great stuff. Some stuff coming up to look forward to. We have sockets. Sockets are a way of doing live interaction. So for example, if you want to make games, if you want to make like live messages, you'll use sockets. We also have a workshop specifically dedicated to games and displaying things on the front end, like, you know, with HTML canvas. That would be on Thursday. We have things like deployment, which will allow you to actually put your website out on the web and have everyone be able to use it instead of going to like localhost 5,000 or 5050. So stay tuned for that. And there's a lot more advanced topics that we'll be covering this week. So should be pretty interesting. But yeah, that is it.